Ja, habe ich ihn. I'd like to begin by asking you an intimate question. Who are you? Who are you truly? Normally, you might respond by giving me your name, perhaps where you live, your profession, things you like, things you don't like, if we have more time, some stories about your life. But if I meet you a few months later, you might have changed your name, you might have lost your job, changed your profession, you might have new stories to tell me. So who are you? You can't be something which changes. You can only be what always is. What part of you always is? What part of you has been a constant throughout all the moments of your life? Think back. Go back even as far as your early childhood. Is there some part of you which existed then, which is still present now? It's not your physical body. It's constantly changing as cells die and are replaced by other cells. It's not your emotions, it's not your memories, it's not your thoughts, they're all changing. What part of you is the same now as when you were 5 years old, 10 years old, 20 years old, 30 years old? What part of you is still here? There's a lot of confusion about this. If I listen to you talking, you'll say things like, "Oh, I'm so tired." And then after a while, you may say, "Oh, I feel so energized." On a cold winter day, you might say things like, "Oh, I'm so cold. I'm freezing." You come inside later and you say, "Oh, I'm hot." Or if you're hungry, you say, "I'm hungry." And after a meal, you say, "I'm not hungry." So who are you? You can't be cold and hot, tired and not tired. You can't be hungry and not hungry, happy and unhappy. These are only thoughts, emotions, experience, which come and go. What part of you never changes? You can notice it even in this moment. But don't even try to label it, because the label changes. You could call it yourself, your higher self, you could call it consciousness, you could call it your soul. But those are only words, and who you are is much more than words. Our first goal in yoga is to realize that. And by realize, I mean not merely to have a glimpse of it like you're having now, but to establish yourself in that perspective. This self, if you will, it's not an object, it's the subject. It's the seer, it's the part of you which sees, which is a witness. An eternal witness. How to cultivate that, how to find it, how to establish oneself in it is the very purpose of yoga. And it begins as we begin to cultivate awareness. Awareness occurs whenever part of your consciousness stands back and watches what's going on. The witness is not doing anything. It's watching things happen. The witness is not thinking about anything. It's watching the thoughts come and go. The witness is not feeling anything. It's watching emotions or feelings rise and fall. all the practices that we do in yoga have as their means and destination the cultivation of this awareness, this witness perspective. Whether it's doing yoga postures to relax the physical body, and when you finish the relaxation, you feel that, that place of contentment, of presence. Whether it's breathing exercises where, as a result, you feel calmness, you let go of the stress of your life. Whether it's meditation, where you let go of the worries and anxiety. Consciousness is the goal. Consciousness is like the light in this room. It's not a phenomenon, it simply is everywhere. The word kriya means action with awareness or consciousness. And it's an antidote to karma, which is action with consequences. Most of us are merely living the consequences of our past actions, thoughts, and words. But as we bring more and more the perspective of the witness, we're able to short-circuit the automatic habits and conditioning which now are controlling us. Kriya, action with awareness. It's our vehicle and our destination. And as a result of practicing it, you're going to bring awareness into all the dimensions of your life. And you're going to realize who you truly are. And maintain that awareness, that self-realization, throughout all the dramas of your life. Namaste.